Build a coalition and become the king's head advisor in the card drafting game King's Coalition from new publisher Play to Zed Games.
Play to Z is a new company founded by Zev Slashinger, the man behind Z-Man Games, along with a host of industry professionals. Now, we've got to thank Zev himself for hooking us up with an advanced review copy of this one, and it is their first published game.
King's Coalition was designed by Derek Croxton and features artwork from Rod Rodriguez. It plays 2 to 5 players and includes 2 modes of play, a regular version and an advanced version. Even the advanced version plays in about half an hour.
The goal of King's Coalition is to draft the best hand of cards by the end of the round, six rounds. Each turn, you will recruit a new card and dismiss a card from your hand. The trick here is that the card is how the cards will score changes each game.
Physically, King's Coalition comes in a small box, which includes the rules, a scoring pad, a first player marker, and 4 bonus point tokens, and cards in 2 sizes. There's the main deck, which is standard size cards that featured number cards from 8 different suits, with the numbers ranging from 0 to 12. The second deck are more larger cards, tarot size cards, that are used for randomizing the game's scoring opportunities. Card quality here is excellent, the iconography is very clear, card abilities are listed right on the cards, as well as being provided on a small reference card.
Like many traditional card games, setting up King's Coalition is quick. You shuffle the main deck and deal everyone 7 cards. You then place 6 cards face down on the table. 4 random scoring cards are dealt, and a scoring token is assigned to each of them.
Every game of King's Coalition starts with 2 scoring cards in play that never change. The first awards points for sets of 3 or more cards from the same suit. The second awards points for numbered straights of 6 or more. In addition to this, every player will score the total of the cards in their hands.
At the start of each round, the start player flips the leftmost face-down card and adds it to the middle of the table, which is called the recruitment area. They also flip over the leftmost scoring card if any are still face-down. For the first 4 rounds, a new way to score bonus points is revealed. These are scored in addition to the 3 standard ways to score Sean just mentioned.
Next up, in turn order, players recruit 1 card and then dismiss 1 card. You can recruit from the recruitment area or from the top of the deck. Dismissals come from your hand, and dismiss cards get placed into the recruitment area to be potentially recruited by other players.
Now, once everyone has recruited and dismissed a card, a start player passes to the left and a new round begins. The game ends after 6 rounds, after the last face-down card is revealed. At that point, players total their points, and the player with the highest total wins.
That all sounds rather simple, but things get interesting because the cards and numbers are not evenly distributed. There are more peasants in the deck than anything else, and peasants are all numbered either 1 or 2. There are only 3 7 cards in the entire deck, and so on. The included reference card shows this distribution and will be useful to reference while playing.
Then there's the fact that some cards have special abilities. In the basic game, you only use the abilities for peasants and ministers. Peasants may be enlisted, where you recruit 1 from the recruitment area. Instead of adding a peasant to your hand, you instead add it to a tableau in front of you. And when you enlist a peasant, you don't dismiss a card, which effectively increases your hand size.
Each of the 5 ministers does something special, and they range from 0 to 7 in value. Each of them has an ability to count as a different card when scoring sets or sequences.
Now, when playing with the advanced rules, every card suit does something special. Apprentices can be enlisted like peasants, but only if you have an apprentice in your hand. Knights can promote other cards to knights. Merchants are worth extra points when part of a sequence, and so on.
We suggest playing a couple of games with the basic rules before adding in any of the advanced rules. The advanced rules are actually really simple once you get going, but I highly recommend a round with just the basic rules whenever you're introducing new players to the game.
Now, finally, the rulebook offers up a method for tournament play where you play 4 games in a row and total your score. For the card counters out there, you can even play with a different set of bonus scoring cards each game, meaning that you will get to see all 16 of them by the time the end of your 4 games.
Now, Deanna and I both got to see King's Coalition when it was just a prototype at GAMA Expo earlier this year. At that point, I watched Zev teach a couple of gamers to play, but didn't myself, but I was intrigued. It looked interesting, and they seemed to be having fun. Then at Origins, both of us, Deanna and I, got a chance to actually sit down and play the game, and we were instantly hooked. hooked enough that we asked Zev if we could take home a copy, and he agreed, as long as we waited until early September to review it. And well, here you are. Thanks, Zev.
One thing I think that's really important to note is that the game isn't hard to learn or play. With the text on the cards and on the reference cards, with all the special abilities in the game, can feel daunting, but it's really not. So long as you play a couple of basic rounds first, when you do introduce those advanced rules, it just flows naturally and nothing becomes overwhelming. You're left wondering why you were so worried.
Yeah, exactly that. The advanced rules flow. They just make sense once you've got the basics down.
Yeah, I agree. The simplicity of this game is what drew me to it in the first place. I love how simple it is to teach, how quick it was to pick up, and how clever the game in-game interactions are. Like, honestly, the basic mechanics are kind of a Racco level of simple, right? You're going to take a card and then discard a card trying to make the best set of cards. It's the card distribution and the ever-changing bonus scoring opportunities that make it so interesting and engaging.
I love the way you have to adapt during the first few rounds as those scoring cards get flipped up one at a time. And then I like how you have a few rounds at the end to try and get everything in order before you're done.
Yeah, it's really interesting as those available cards and new scoring opportunities arriving slowly throughout the game really shift your plan so that your initial and final plans may be wildly different.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, there's something about King's Coalition. Just, I don't know, feels well balanced and well play tested. Like Play Dizzy did their work, or they picked a good game to hire that had some work behind it. I don't know what it is. When deciding what to take early in the round might be simple. You're like, well, I'm going to go for a set. I need a six and I'll have a full set. I might as well grab that. But then once those other bonus scoring cards come up that can be worth a significant amount of points, you're going to get to a point where you're going to have to go, am I going to go for that? Or am I going to go for that? Or am I going to try to score these two, which is worth five more points? And then sometimes you can do that, but most of the time you've got to push your luck, hoping for the right card to come up. And having that reference card on hand can really help with that.
Yeah, the reference cards for this game are super useful. Like, there are eight different card types, and each has its own range of numbers, right? So, for example, the peasants are all ones and twos. Well, the gentry comes in three, fours, and fives. And if you're waiting for a six in the gentry, it's not going to be coming up.
Right.
Looking at the reference card can stop you from waiting for a card that is either rare or simply doesn't exist. Knowing you can't possibly get a three while sticking to the card types you're trying to aim for is helpful.
Yeah, and when you're ready to move to the advanced rules, the reference cards are a great boon there, too. Just don't let them scare you.
Yeah, the card text on the cards themselves is very clear. And I've got to say, for anyone new to the game, ignore as much as possible of the advanced rules. They're presented different. They're in black. They say advanced rules. Don't even read them. Don't look at them. They're just going to scare you. They're going to confuse you and overwhelm you. But once you play at least one game with the basic rules first, and you've got down, once you've got it down and kind of see how the game plays, all of those advanced rules are just going to make sense. They're going to make perfect sense. You're going to read it and go, oh, I understand why I might want to do this. Oh, I know why knights promote, because I'm going to want to get these bonuses. You don't want to worry about that stuff your first play. That's just going to overwhelm people. The game's not that hard. There is, we talk about onboarding in board games. This game has awesome onboarding. Start with the basic rules, then move on to the advanced. Because by the time you play the advanced, it honestly makes perfect sense.
Yeah, I think my favorite part of King's Coalition is the fact that the cards you dismiss go into a pool and can be taken by other players. I love that feeling of wanting to help yourself, but also not wanting to help out your opponents too much. And sometimes it's easy to know what to discard, but I relish those times when it's a hard choice. Like, do I toss away a high-numbered card to complete a set or a series, or do I keep it for face value points? Because some of those nobles, they go up to 12, and you do get points for the face value, right? Do I give a peasant to a player that's been enlisting peasants every turn, or do I break up a potential set so I can discard something else? Like, those are all choices that you have to make, and I enjoy that.
And so far, I've yet to see this game fail. We played it with the kids, we played with seniors at the table, we played with family, we played with gamers at local public play events. Every time, it's gone over well, with most people asking to play a second time after the first round. And I got to say, some tables asking for more after that. We've had someone at one of our Walkerville Brewery events that just kind of held on to the game all night for a while, playing multiple rounds. That said, I wouldn't say this game's for everyone. This is not a game with universal appeal, because this is a card game. And a fairly traditional playing card style of card game, a set collection game. Like all playing card games, there is a lot of randomness, and luck of the draw is going to be a thing.
I like that this game is easy to teach and that it's an easy step up for people who play traditional card games.
Yes, this is very much a gateway card game. Super easy to take your standard card player, anyone who's used to any sort of game like this, and you can bring them along on a path into hobby games with this win.
So overall, King's Coalition is being a big hit for us. I think this is a great game to help launch a new company, and I think it's going to appeal to a large range of gamers, which is perfect for a startup. It's got a nice short play time, but doesn't feel like a small game. Every game of King's Coalition I played has been interesting and tense, and I never know until the cards are revealed at the end if I've got a chance of winning or not.
I love how quickly it plays. It's light and quick and easy, while still having just enough meat on its bones to keep me satisfied.
If you dig traditional card games, especially set collection games, gin, rummy, that type of thing, you really should pick up King's Coalition. Now, if you like modern dedicated deck card games, you should also check this out. Set collection board game fans will probably also like it. And anyone who's looking for a thinky filler, short games with plenty of depth, especially once you move on to the advanced rules, you're going to find that here.
Now, due to the straightforward rules, there's plenty of room for chat and banter at the table while playing. You don't need to worry about deep focus and distraction as the game flows quite smoothly.
Now, if you don't like card games, due to the luck of the draw element, you can probably skip King's Coalition. So if you happen to have a chance to do a demo or play around, give it a shot. You might just enjoy it. Now, one final note, I have heard this game compared to Fantasy Realms many times. It's Fantasy Realms light, or it's a toned down Fantasy Realms, or it's Fantasy Realms where the card powers aren't ridiculous. Now, I'm sorry to say we have not played Fantasy Realms, so I can't actually comment on that myself. Now, others have said, if you dig Fantasy Realms, give this a shot. So take that as it is.
Well, that's the end of our review of King's Coalition. It's time to reveal our hands and add up the points.
Now, if you've enjoyed this review, let us know by giving us a thumbs up, like, retweet, blog, etc. Even better would be to do that and leave us a comment, because we love comments.